It is cold. So cold I can't bear to cast off my blanket to face another, freezing Boston morning. I roll over, burying my head under a pillow to block out sunlight filtered through iron-gray clouds. Footsteps out my bedroom proceed to the sound of my doorframe creaking open. Time to wake up, buddy. You're gonna be late for school. I ignore my father's voice, pretending to be asleep. If you're up in the next half hour, I can drop you off on the way to work. I remain quiet, the blanket rising and falling in time with my breaths. It is so warm and comfortable here. I don't want to leave. Come on, buddy. I know it sucks, but you gotta wake up. I don't want to face what I know I'll have to. Wake up, son. Come on. Wake up. A dull ache throbs in my skull as I awake to being dragged across the forest floor. I still feel numb, my eyes drifting in and out of focus. One of them feels sticky and warm, gummed up with clotting blood. I remember the head wound. I remember where I am. There's an intense pressure around my ankles as dry twigs and pine needles scratch at my face and hands. Twisting my body, I try to look up at the living atrocity that hauls me through the woods. The creature has me in a vice grip, a ghastly mess of flesh and bone that almost resembles the claw of a lobster is clamped so tightly that I begin to lose all feeling in my feet. The pale, molted flesh on its back is stretched and ripped by hideous bone protrusions that gleam with what I can only realize are spent bullets. Abnormal organs pulse and spasm beneath skin that's tracked with blackened blood vessels which pump a dark, vicious fluid around in its body. I panic, twisting in its grip again, my fingers digging into the dirt, trying in vain to find any kind of way to get out of this. The thing stops, turning toward me. I can see its many eyes in my peripheral vision. Gelatinous masses of shimmering jelly. But I can't look into them. I won't. I won't lose my mind like Noah lost his. Noah. Oh God, what did they do to you? I feel the thing's grasp begin to tremble with fury, grunts of wild rage sounding in its throat as its nostrils flare like some berserk primate. Vicious tendrils of drool begin to slip from its maw, landing hot and slimy on the waterproof lining of my clothes. It is hungry.
Father. Not now, Father. Not yet.
Morgan. That treacherous, conniving bastard. Hate blooms back in my heart, tempered only by grief for my fallen friend. I don't want to believe it. Don't want to believe the horrific sparks of memory that light up the void of unconsciousness. I turn again, shifting my prostrate form until he comes into view. His eyes, ringed by black circles of exhaustion, they stare back at me, unfeeling. To my infinite disgust, I actually see him smile, but not the smile I had come to know over the past year or so. Not the smile of a friend. This is the smile of a predator. Morgan followed as the creature dragged me back into the bunker facility, down the long, dark corridors, until we were once again in the large hall containing the huge, druidic artifact. There it stood, dwarfing the three of us with its ungodly size as the creature tossed me down onto the hard, steel floor, before disappearing into the darkness once again. The impact knocked the wind out of me, a sharp pain in my chest now accompanying the dull ache in my head. It took me a second to pull myself up onto my hands and knees, summoning every last ounce of strength as I desperately prepared to make it or break it.
Don't get any ideas there, mate.
Morgan's flashlight blinded me, the metallic clack as he pulled back the revolver's hammer. What the hell is going on, Morgan?
Oh, I suppose you do deserve an explanation, You're going to give us so much. The least I can do is give you a few answers.
With the same smug smile on his lips, Morgan sat down on the cold steel floor next to me, still aiming the revolver squarely in my direction.
Do you know the story of the Roman 9th Legion?
I made no reply.
Imagine, you're a Roman soldier, living in a shining beacon of civilization, one of law and order, tradition and piety. And then, you're told you're going to Britannia, that dark and miserable wilderness on the very far reaches of the Empire. You've heard the stories, an ancient land of monsters and savagery, where the elders consume poison to commune with their barbaric, reasonless gods. You just joined for 3 square meals, but now you're off to God knows where to fight God knows who. I suppose some things never change.
Morgan chuckled, and in the dim torchlight, I saw the madness in his eyes.
Your ship lands on a barren, rocky coast. You wonder just how anyone can live in a freezing, sodden wasteland that barely knows the sun's warmth. You don't understand the local people. You start to see them as something less than human. You wet your sword at Kaer Caradoc, letting it taste the blood of tribesmen. Yet, the further north you travel, the wilder the land and the people become, until you're in a place so far from the light of Rome, you wonder if such a place can ever be truly civilized. Here, in the land they call Caledonia, you encounter savage, naked warriors screaming as they tear through the forest with tattooed faces and painted flesh. Their weapons crafted from carved bone. They charge into battle, unafraid of death, because for them, death in battle meant more than just reaching the peaceful fields of Elysium. It meant immortality. For the overlords of these men had filled their empty heads with unholy ideas of resurrection, fortifying them with groundless beliefs in an unending cycle of life and death. These were the Druids. The Druids ate algaric mushrooms to commune with their gods. You know the kind, the little red ones with white spots, famous for their hallucinogenic properties. During the crisis that was the Roman invasion, religious ceremonies went into overdrive. The druidic shaman began rituals that would last for days, weeks even, constantly consuming mushrooms until they either lost their minds or lost their lives. Never had they known horror such as the legions. Mass crucifixions, ingeniously unpleasant forms of torture, captured warriors ripped apart by horses. To the local tribes, it was the Romans who were savages, not them. It was a catastrophe. All hope seemed lost. Old tribes became refugees, fleeing north into the highlands to evade the cruel hand of the emperor. They begged and pleaded with their gods, but none responded. Again and again, the druids invoked their silent gods, crying out for them to cease their indifference. Then, out of the great, vast void they called into, something called back. Something they didn't recognize. Something that, unlike their fabled deities, didn't have a name. And here's another thing the history books won't tell you. Around the same time that Agricola led his troops across the Caledonian frontier, a twin-tailed comet hurtled through the sky and smashed into the forests inhabited by the western tribes. When they went to investigate the disturbance, this is what they found.
Morgan nodded towards the huge, black monolith, towering over us in the center of the darkened room.
It must have been buried in the earth, maybe only a few feet protruding from the earth's surface. But that didn't matter. It didn't dampen the thing's potency. The druids began to communicate with something far more powerful than their own meager collection of gods. It taught them to read the runes inscribed on the otherworldly black stone, and when they'd learned all their new, dark masters had to teach them, they were offered a gift. A gift that gave them the power to take the forces of the mightiest empire known to man and crush them into dust. But the only way to receive their new gift was not by another comet, nor via some warp port or tear in time and space. The doorway would be the one thing on this earth that truly straddles the material world and the one just beyond it. A human body. The strongest warrior of the Western tribes proved to be an unworthy tribute. He was torn asunder in a powerful display of the new master's displeasure. What they wanted was not a vessel of great strength, but one of great wisdom. One with a mind capable of comprehending the great and terrible secrets of their creation. The oldest and most scholarly of the shaman stepped forth, offering his body as a womb for the child of what they came to call the Old Ones. They found him adequate, and throughout the night of the ritual, his body was slowly and painfully disfigured as something not of this world was birthed into him. Women danced in drug-fueled reveries. Men beat their goatskin drums, all as the shaman's screams of tortured joy rang up into the night sky. His body was being torn apart, broken down and rebuilt. But the things he saw, the visions that sprang up behind his eyes, made him roar in orgasmic bliss. A fate worse than death, yes. But those visions, that knowledge, I'd tear my eyes out to see such things.
"You're sick," I hissed. The pointed revolver, the only thing stopping me from choking the life out of him. Morgan ignored me, continuing with his morbid tale.
The following night, the creature headed up a tribal warband that ambushed an encampment of the Ninth Legion. Soldiers were slaughtered as they slept, each one taken by the beast, a fresh tribute to the Old Ones. But the thing that used to be a shaman needed a refuge of its own. A place to rest in between feeding frenzies. So it built a nest. A nest that it decorated with the trophies of its victims.
We saw that place, didn't we?
We did. No one had laid eyes on that place for nearly 2,000 years. No one could ever get close enough. But we did. And now you know why.
Listen to yourself. What are you even saying? What you're saying is impossible. It's insane. You really think that goddamn thing is your father?
Why do you think we're still alive? Father was watching us this whole time. He didn't kill us because he remembers me. It's been almost 20 years of pain and madness, but he still remembers me. His only begotten son.
How? How can you possibly expect me to believe any of this? How the hell did you... Why did you... Oh God. The vision of Noah's brains being splattered across the forest floor made my eyes burn with tears. Why, man? Why Noah?
I couldn't have him hurting Father. Especially not before something so important. I suppose to explain how Father came to be like, well, like that, I have to tell you another story. Have you heard of the Hundred Hour War? It's what some people call the First Gulf War. It took a little over 4 days to subdue the entire Iraqi military machine. 4 days. NATO hasn't been able to break the backs of a few Afghan goat herders in 18 years. But you honestly think they routed 500,000 men and thousands of tanks in just 4 bloody days? Come off it, mate. You're much smarter than that. No, the reason they call it the 100-Hour War is because of that.
Morgan nodded towards the great, black monolith once again.
The British government spent billions exploring that thing's secrets. Failure after failure brought them steps closer towards a successful summoning, until, one day, it worked. The beast they brought forth was sedated and dropped into the Kuwaiti desert on the 24th of February 1991. A few days later, the war was over, But there was a problem. The British Ministry of Defense has lost all control of their top-secret bioweapon, resulting in what we now call the Highway of Death. Coalition Command had initially decided to allow a huge convoy of fleeing Iraqi soldiers to safely escape from Kuwait City. The war was practically won. The enemy in full retreat. There was no need to continue the killing. But word had spread that the asset they called Project Hadrian was rampaging towards the convoy, ignoring the biochemical commands of its handlers. That night, for 10 whole hours, the coalition bombed and strafed the convoy into oblivion. Thousands were killed, both by Allied warplanes and the rogue asset that their bombs were meant for. But eventually, Project Hadrian was subdued and liquidated. Yet another casualty of the world's first truly modern conflict.
So your father, that thing?
Just the next generation of test subjects. Like the wise druid before him, he was one of the few men capable of understanding the crushingly cynical nature of our universe. But, sadly to say, he too went rogue. For the call of the Old Ones is far stronger than anything man can hope for.
How could you possibly know all of this?
I dedicated my life to it. Father disappeared when I was young. They told me he was dead, but I knew otherwise. I could feel he was still alive. He left enough clues in the books he left around our family home. Books on druidic rituals, theoretical physics, and runic translation. I learned all I could, was accepted on a scholarship to university, and, well, that's where we met, isn't it?
You mean you've planned all of this?
Of course I did. I had to. It took years. Years of grooming the right people. Seeing if they had what it took to get me this far. But also, to see if they were capable of what's to come.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to bring Father back. But to do so, I need a person of the right constitution. The right intelligence. We need you, mate. We need your body to transfer the gift to.
What? Me? You can't.
I thought you'd understand. You too lost your father when you were young. You know all that pain and loss. All the unanswered questions. Questions you will never get answers to. Yours is gone forever, but I have a chance to bring mine back. To save him from what he's become. Wouldn't you want that? Wouldn't you do everything you could to bring him back?
His words cut like a knife. I remained silent.
Just as I thought. Besides, you can take comfort in the knowledge that you'll be part of something greater.
What are you going to do?
No more questions. It's time.
Morgan placed his torch on the ground, pointing it at the monolith to illuminate his path towards it. With the revolver still in his grip, he rose to his feet, approaching the huge stone artifact with awe in his eyes. For just a moment, he was distracted. The thought to rush him flashed through my mind, and I prepared to launch myself at the man I had once thought of as a friend. The man who murdered Noah. But as I did so, something moved in the darkness beside me. I heard the creature's low growl, its hot breath on the back of my neck as it stood guard just a few feet away. As Morgan drew closer to the monolith, he reached out, laying a hand on it and whispering something under his breath. I strained my ears to hear the words, but it was like nothing I had ever heard. Dark, guttural noises sounding from the back of Morgan's throat as he spoke a language that was clearly not meant for human tongue. It was like nails on a chalkboard. I winced as I began to piece together syllables. My body racked with nausea, head aching as the unfamiliar words echoed around my skull. Yet, I didn't have time to reflect upon the intense discomfort. My sanity was almost shattered by the madness that began to unfold before me. the black monolith started to glow. Each of the tiny, intricately carved runes etched into its surface began to pulse with a grim, green glimmer. Morgan's incantations became increasingly more intense. The green light glowing brighter and brighter until the whole surface gleamed so strongly that everything was bathed in the hideous green luminosity. Morgan grasped as his body became rigid, his eyeballs rolling in their sockets, as something reached out and spoke to him from beyond the void.
"Father,"
he exclaimed, a mad kind of wonder in his voice.
"I see them. Eyes as big as the planets."
The creature roared as it too approached the monolith, bathing in its sickening, verdant radiance as Morgan was overcome.
"I see them. Eyes as big as the planets."
But the old ones had made their decision. It was the creature's turn to go rigid, frozen in its place as its many, many eyes burned with the same green glow that festered on the monolith. Its limbs twitched and dangled like some hideous marionette as the old ones began to reclaim what was theirs. In a flash, the creature threw its huge clawed hand into Morgan, sending him curling across the hall before he landed with a thickening crunch.
"Father, please."
He groaned, a freshly broken wrist flopping grotesquely as he tried and failed to find his feet.
"It's me, your son. I beg you, it doesn't have to be like this. I know you're in there now. Please, don't do this."
There was no mournful groan from the creature this time. No deep, sorrowful whimper from the thing that was once Morgan's father. It made a sound that, for the first time, made me see how the abomination before my eyes could once have been human. It laughed. It laughed as it tore into him, puncturing Morgan's chest cavity with its clawed hand as it used the other one to tear off its legs at the hip. A shower of blood, almost black in the green glow, erupted from his raggedly torn thigh as it was flung across the hall. Organs were pulverized by devastating blows, flesh shredded and pulped by the creature's terrifying strength. When only the head was left intact, the creature cradled Morgan's blood-soaked cranium in its grip for a moment, before it cracked open the skull and feasted on the mess inside. As the hall filled the nauseating, sloppy shucking sound that emanated from the creature's maw, I saw the one thing that could give me a way out. It was the one single thing that could save me from a fate as hellish as Morgan's. The revolver. With the creature momentarily distracted with his meal, I crawled over towards the old sidearm, stretching my arm painfully to grab a hold of it. I was surprised at how clear the answer seemed to be in the moment, how easily I found myself cocking the hammer, putting my finger on the trigger, placing the barrel to my temple. When people talk about how your life flashes before your eyes, it's not entirely untrue. My heart was pounding as I felt the cold steel of the revolver, my hand trembling as I thought of all the people I owed an apology to. All the people that would forever wonder how I disappeared in the forest of Scotland. How cruel it seemed to be on my mom, that she could lose both her husband and her son within just a few years. But then I thought of Noah, of the dopey look in his eyes as he lay dead among the fallen leaves. I thought of my father too, how peaceful he looked in that hospital bed, the steady beeping of the heart monitor, the gentle hush of the life support machines pumping air into his lungs. I would be seeing them both again very soon, and with one quick jerk of a finger, I pulled the trigger. Nothing. The hammer fell with a dull click. I pulled again and again, and still nothing. The round in the chamber had misfired. It was a dud. I broke down hearing the creature slinking over me for a fresh meal, but I couldn't turn to it. I couldn't watch it. I simply surrendered to my fate in hope that, when death came, it wasn't too excruciating. But the pain was unbearable. The burning sensation of the thing beginning to peel the flesh from my calves sent a shrill scream of agony erupting from my throat. I could feel it using its hideously malformed mandibles to probe my blood vessels, but it was draining more than just blood. I could feel it taking everything. I twisted in place, aiming the revolver at the creature's many eyes in one last desperate attempt to save my life. The bullet in the final chamber of the revolver was still very much functional. The booming report of the sidearm echoing around the huge hall as the half-inch chunk of lead ripped into the thing's deformed features. It howled, strange luminescent fluid pouring from its ruptured eyeball. The green glow of the monolith suddenly erupted, burning so brightly that the entire structure seemed to be consumed with raw, eldritch energies. I was blinded, throwing my hands up to my face as a booming cacophony seemed to vibrate through my very core. It was a voice, the voice of the old ones. Suddenly, it's hard to breathe. I gasped for air, but my chest was racked with pain from the lack of it. Blinded, panicking and half mad, I once again slipped into unconsciousness. When I finally awoke, I was laying on the forest floor. Even in a state of semi-consciousness, I sensed how incredibly weak I was, how drained and withered my body felt, as I tried and failed to pull myself up onto my feet. It had only been a day or two since we had ventured into the woods, but my hands looked emaciated. The hair on my arms had turned a kind of salt and pepper gray. When I finally did drag myself in the dirt, walking was agony. My knees hurt and my back ached, doubtless from the loss of blood caused by the rampaging creature. Yet, as I checked the leg it had easily torn open, there was no wound. Only a hideous, ragged collection of scar tissue on my dry, wrinkled skin. It took hours for me to get out of the woods. Hours to find a road that even looked like it might head back to civilization. But when I did, then I almost wept with joy as my blurry eyes managed to distinguish the dark concrete among the greenery. I prayed for rescue. I prayed I would see someone, anyone, on the road back to town. They could call an ambulance, the cops, anyone who would have saved a dying young man. The lone survivor of a nightmare too grotesque to recall. Then I saw them. A small group walking towards me on the narrow, hedge-rimmed lane. I tried to cry out, but my throat was bone dry. My voice was raspy and weak. I tried to wave, but they didn't see me. Too busy arguing amongst themselves. They stopped, stunned into silence by the sudden appearance of a solitary figure in the road before them. I simply stood there, near the grass verge, still wearing the filthy, tattered clothes that looked so different a few days ago. Yet, as I took a few more steps towards them, I froze in horror at what I saw before me. It was us. It was Morgan, Noah, and me. "No, no," I hissed, my voice hoarse, weak-sounding, as if it had been a very, very long time since I'd spoken. My mind refused to compute such an impossible revelation. It had to be some kind of fever dream, a nightmarish hallucination brought on by trauma of my experiences. It was me that was the skittish old hermit we met on the way in the forest. Here I was, watching my younger self about to walk off into the forest and repeat the unholy cycle all over again. A crushing, inescapable cosmic loop. A joke played on us by the ageless beings that slumber in the deepest recesses of the universe. Beings that, as Morgan said, saw us as little more than maggots feasting on a rotten corpse. I couldn't bring myself to say another word, not even as they said their goodbyes and passed me in the road. I simply stood there, watching them trudge towards their doom, my doom, as the final few shreds of my sanity begin to unravel and slip away. And I, too, was lost to the void.